Okay, I think we'll go ahead and get started. Want to point out that if you guys have any questions throughout the webinar, feel free to just throw them in the chat. My colleague Joel here will be able to answer questions as we go, or if there's any we leave for the end, we can spend time to answer those. So, again, good morning. Or afternoon, depending on where you're at. I really appreciate you all taking time out of your day to join me for this webinar. My name is Garrett Klima. I've been a CFD engineer here at Flow Science for about 2 years now. I've mainly been focusing on applications within both metal casting and additive manufacturing. Today's webinar shouldn't take more than 20 minutes or so. We'll have time at the end. Like I said, to answer questions if Joel isn't able to answer them throughout. But I'm going to talk about thin-walled castings and how we use Flow-3D cast to solve filling-related issues. Why are thin-walled castings being made in general? What challenges are unique to parts with thin walls? And why is casting simulation a true necessity in tool and die design? I'll then go through a few steps of the runner and overflow design process for a mock structural part so that we can see an example of the workflow in a way that should be really simple and easy to follow, but also provide some value for any level of experience. Speaking somewhat generally, I guess, the main reason that we want to implement high pressure die castings is the ability to combine multiple high production volume parts into one casting. This not only reduces weight intuitively, but most importantly, cost. Die casting in lightweight alloys are definitely not a new concept, with magnesium alloys dating back somewhere around the early 20th century with Germany, but parts made with the die casting process historically have been limited to either smaller components or thick-walled pieces like wheels, engine blocks, and transmission cases. Larger structural parts for automotive have been made by assembling numerous steel stampings since those structural parts, they have strength and ductility and thickness requirements that lightweight alloys just haven't been able to comply with until pretty recently. Over the last 10 to 15 years or so, though, there's been a pretty big push in the automotive industry to reduce weight in vehicles so that they can comply with, in part, with fuel emission regulations. Along with the advancements in these alloy developments, pretty huge progress in die clamping force, which we have been seeing a lot of recently, as well as vacuum and cooling system design, and then precise process variable control have really allowed manufacturers to cast these bigger parts and meet their lightweighting goals. Simplifying multiple parts into a single die casting sounds great, but in reality, there's really difficult challenges there that R&D teams across the globe are working really hard to solve. In line somewhat with the second law of thermodynamics, as complexity of the cast parts increases, the complexity of the manufacturing solution increases as well, to the point where previous design practices may no longer be valid and new ideas need to be brainstormed. Another thing is that when you compare aluminum and magnesium alloys to stamped steel, there's a significant difference in ductility, which is going to be crucial in absorbing force and crashes so that they aren't brittle and just break. But the mechanical properties can be improved by heat treatment, but that just adds another step. On the flip side, though, the high strength to weight ratios and the fluidity of the aluminum alloys are, have been able to drive engineers to tackle these challenges and come up with unique solutions and design and cast these complex parts so that they can continue on this path of weight reduction. It's clear that as more advanced structural alloys are developed, we're just going to see more and more parts be replaced by increasingly large die castings. Die casting truly is this huge beast of an engineering problem to solve. So many factors can affect the quality of a part. And since we can't use our eyes to see through the die while the process is taking place, and trial and error is really costly, not only in money, but with time, somehow we need to be able to predict the outcome of a design before we actually make the tools. Fluid simulation allows us to effectively use X-ray vision and slow down time so that we can see and analyze the effect of the process and design changes on the filling and solidification of parts in this digital or virtual space, with the key point here being, and reiterating this, before the tools are cut. Accurately predicting the defects caused by gas and shrinkage porosity, early freeze and stress, save companies a ton of money by reducing or even eliminating the trial and error needed to finalize a tool design. As the casting size increases, the tool changes will become even more cost prohibitive than they already are, and accurate simulation will be more important than ever. Besides that defect reduction, simulation allows for a pretty true process optimization, which will save money in material waste as well as in having higher quality parts. So to talk more specifically about thin walls now, casting parts with a high mold surface area to thickness ratio is a very complex fluid dynamics problem, which is where we come in. Structural die cast alloys like aluminum, they have high thermal conductivity properties, which means that they cool really rapidly when they're in contact with the mold. So this time window that we have available to fill is very small before they solidify. And then you combine this with thin parting lines, and then we get really high gate velocities, then turbulence, and thus entrained air. Because of the thermal conductivity of the metal, like we're talking about, it's pretty easy for these air pockets to get trapped by the surrounding solidification fronts. The filling pattern of the metal fronts colliding and evolving as these as the metal exits the gates and interacts with each other has the highest effect on this entrained air. And understanding the pattern dynamics of the metal flowing out of the gates lets you place overflows in an efficient manner so that you can capture these areas while still minimizing the overflow volume and pour weight from that. That is all a mouthful to say that the filling pattern is determined by three things: the casting shape, the runner design, and the process parameters. For the most part, we're not able to, you know, significantly change the part geometry to provide the most optimal filling. So using simulation to iterate through runner designs and process parameters is the way problems need to be solved. Because of the complexity of the actual fluid dynamics in HPDC, it only makes sense to use a tool specialized in solving the fluid flow. FLOW-3D Cast offers the most accurate solution for predicting the complex flow dynamics in a die casting. It uses the volume of fluid method to track the evolution of the volume, the fluid free surface, and it's proved very consistently to be the most accurate on the market in predicting the behavior of these violent fluid flows, which is what allows me to make that strong of a statement saying that it's the best on the market. If you've been around the block for a while, you might notice that other casting simulations look somewhat viscous, even with high fluidity metals, while ours look very natural. This mostly comes from taking into account the momentum of the fluid, which I can't say for sure that other softwares don't, but from afar, it doesn't look like it. Again, the accuracy of the filling simulations is absolutely crucial when we're trying to decide which specific changes to make to solve certain problems. So let's go through an example that I made that kind of illustrates in a simple way how we iterate towards an improved design for a structural part. The A pillar or a hinge pillar is part of the vehicle structure that sits between the front wheel hub and the driver and passenger door. And it's a important component in multiple ways, but especially in regard to the overall body structure and the crash system. It's typically made, historically of multiple high strength steel stampings, but casting gives it a pretty significant reduction of weight by combining them. In the bottom right over here is kind of a rendering of the body structure for a Cadillac CT6, which shows the mix of steel and aluminum castings in its structure. These are, really the types of parts that we're seeing become more and more common in newer cars. And then along with this, even bigger mega castings. So this model I used in this example isn't for any real vehicle, but it represents something similar in shape and size to an A-pillar for demonstration purposes. A good die-cast alloy for this part would be something like A365 aluminum, which is what I use here. Since it's weldable, it's easily weldable, and it has high fluidity when it's in its liquid state, which makes it very castable for thin walls. It also has pretty solid mechanical properties, especially for elongation. And that's important considering it's a big part of the cast crash system. And like I mentioned before, those properties could be improvable if we go through heat treating. The mass of the part comes out to about 4¾ kilograms, and it has a minimum wall thickness of about 2 millimeters. I'm hoping that you all can join me in this imaginary world that I created, where we're all CFD engineers and our fellow casting designer has given us an initial runner and gating design for the A-pillar. And they want us to test the filling behavior in Flow-3D cast and report back with recommended design changes. Based on the existing, machine and high vacuum system that we have, plus the known casting volume and the filling time requirements, we've also come up with the following process parameters to start our simulation models with. We'll start with out the shot sleeve and fill from the biscuit, starting at the end of slow shot, and then ramping up to the fast shot in about 25 milliseconds once the runner is halfway full. So immediately, when we look at our first model of our first runner design, we see this problematic area down in the bottom left corner where the flow from these two perpendicular gates creates a vortex and makes that area fill close to last. And then once it does fill, it has a lot of entrained air, which would make it a pretty good hotspot for potential porosity. So we're gonna head back to our designer and have him change the introduction angle of that far runner so that it coincides less perpendicularly with its neighboring gate and see if that helps the flow behavior. Design change is really simple, but hopefully allows for a more favorable flow being introduced in that area. Our next analysis shows us that the metal indeed is being introduced into that region sooner, but there's nowhere for the entrained air to exit the casting. So again, we need to go back to our design engineer and ask for an overflow to be added so that entrained air can be removed from the casting part. Our designer creates this little kicker overflow, which is carefully positioned and oriented so that the natural momentum of the metal traps itself in another vortex flow, but this time within the overflow. And this design should prevent any backflow by trapping the fluid in a circular pattern. And we can see the effect of the overflow here working pretty much exactly as intended. The flow enters the overflow, and that region no longer is a hotspot for air entrainment or potential porosity. And then looking at, you know, side by side, just the first design and this last one with the overflow, you know, we're able to clearly see that, you know, in just a few iterations, we're able to solve a pretty major filling issue. But, you know, this is just one aspect of the filling of this part. And then more work will be needed as we increase the complexity of the model by, you know, introducing the plunger and then going through solidification and looking at other defects. So it's about all. The thing I want to drill home from this short of a presentation is that, you know, Flow 3D Cast is very tried and true in delivering the most accurate results, specifically for these highly turbulent flows like in die casting. It really simplifies the design process. And, you know, as die castings increase in size, these simulations will be extremely essential because we're, you know, you're not going to be able to afford mistakes when these dies are millions of dollars to create. So you really need to hit it on the first try, at least in terms of these high return on investment areas like runners and overflows where you're actually cutting into the die. And then, you know, we can go through process parameters later on, not quite as important because, you know, you don't need to make changes to the actual design of the die. So that's all I have for you guys. Thank you. If you guys have any questions, feel free to throw them out. And otherwise, we recorded this presentation and we'll send it out to you pretty shortly after we're done here, I believe. And, you know, feel free to reach out if you have any other questions about, you know, high pressure die casting or just the software in general, and we'll reach out and answer those for you.